You may be seated. You may be seated. It is a great morning. As we shared with you guys, we are celebrating baptisms this morning. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with the church or just don't know how we do things here, we celebrate believers' baptism. We believe that when Jesus left the earth, he told us to tell people what he had done, tell people what he had taught, and that they were to repent and be baptized. So when someone can publicly proclaim that they believe that Jesus died for their sins, defeated death, and rose again, and they intend to follow Jesus, we offer that in a symbol of baptism. We have a couple folks that are coming to be baptized today, and so I'd ask Fred and Eli if you want to come forward. And our ladder assistant. Y'all pay attention to me over here. Don't stare at the folks. It's brisk. It's refreshing.
Dive, Eli.
And everybody floats. Eli Smith, do you believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins?
Yes.
Have you asked Jesus to forgive you of your sins and live in your heart?
Yes.
And is it your intention to follow Jesus and do the things that he taught us to do for the rest of your life?
Yes.
Eli Aaron Smith, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk. New life.
Here is my wife. I'm looking for my wife because she has my towel. All right, praise the Lord. Brown to come join me. It's a little brisk.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Michael Brown comes to make his public profession of faith this morning, and we love it when we do baptisms that people of all ages are able to stand up and proclaim their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Michael, do you believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins and defeated death?
Yes.
Have you asked forgiveness of your sins and put your trust in the grace of Jesus Christ?
Every day.
And is it your intention to follow Jesus and do the things that he taught us to do the rest of your life?
Of course for us.
Michael Brown, grab my hand here. On your profession of faith, I baptize you today in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now it's your opportunity to continue in worship and proclaim what you believe by standing and continuing in song this morning.
Amen. Let's continue on in worship this morning.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined on. Keep him from rising again, living. Here I am, Lord, and I'm drowning in your sea of forgetfulness. The chains of yesterday surround me. I yearn for peace and rest. I don't want to end up where you found me. And it echoes in my mind, keeps me awake tonight. I know you cast my sin as far as the east is from the west, and I stand before you now. Though I've never sinned, today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is from the west? 'Cause I can't bear to see the man I've been, the rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find rest. 'Cause you know just how far the east is from the west, from one scarred hand to the other. Endless reminding of my sin. Time and time again, your truth is drowned out by the storm I'm in. Today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is from the west? 'Cause I can't bear to see the man I've been.
Continue in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your great love, which we can never be separated from. But we thank you most of all for your Son, Jesus, the gift that's been given to us, that when we put our faith and trust in it, separates us from our sin and reconciles us to you. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to just turn our eyes upward, to focus on you, to give ourselves to you, and to surrender to you what you have for us in this place today. In Jesus' name, amen.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore.
So we pour out our praise.
All right, so we changed up the layout a little bit today to accommodate the baptistry, and I will do, can you actually leave that there? I will do my best to talk to all of you as we walk around a little bit, but we're so glad you're here today. Thank you for being with us. Just a reminder, we are under a face covering mandate outside if you cannot maintain a 6-foot social distance. So what that means is if you are in your seat right now, you are 6 feet apart from the people you should be socially distancing from. So that's fine. But as you're coming and going and approaching and passing, please have a face covering on as you enter and leave the tent, as that is what we have been asked to do. And we want to do the things that we are asked to do and be responsible good citizens. So if you're seated, you're fine. You are distanced. But as you are coming and going, please follow those directives for us. It's a crazy time right now. We live in a world where uncertainty, we would not sully the good name of uncertainty by calling what we're dealing with right now uncertainty. This is kind of beyond uncertainty. This is wild times, all right? And that's why today's sermon is called Leading in the Wild. What does it look like to lead or maintain influence in a world that is so uncertain? How many of you feel like you lead someone in some fashion at some point, right? You might be a parent, you might be an employer, you might be a boss, you might be a wife, but at some point you lead. Some of y'all caught that. You lead. How many of you feel like you influence people on a regular basis? All right, you might have a circle of friends and you're the loudest or the tallest or the smartest or the prettiest or the smartest, but you influence people. And here's the reality that is true for each and every one of us. If you did not raise your hand, you should have, because each and every one of us leads someone or influences someone. It might be a lot of people, it might be a few people, but each and every one of us has that power. I want to share a story with you because baseball kind of kicked back off recently. I know some of you are very happy about that. You can't watch it in person, but it still exists, right? And I have to tell you about one of the first games I ever watched on television. It was 1993, so I was about 10, 11 years old, and I'm sitting, I'm watching baseball, and it was the Rangers versus the White Sox. And the Rangers versus the White Sox, for about the last 3 years at that point, had this very edgy, tumultuous relationship. Some people had been hit with a few balls here and there. And at the pitcher's mound for the Rangers was a 46-year-old Nolan Ryan. And in the batter's box for the White Sox was a very young Robbie Ventura. All right, does anybody know the story that I'm about to tell? So Nolan Ryan hit Robbie Ventura with a pitch, and the young rookie decided to charge the mound. And the 46, I believe he was the oldest pitcher in the league at the time, the 46-year-old Nolan Ryan grabbed Robbie Ventura in a headlock and just beat him about the head for a good 3 minutes. And whenever Ventura would cover up his head, Nolan Ryan would hit him in the face. And whenever he would cover up his face, he would hit him in the head. It was awesome. And the dugouts emptied. The managers were screaming at each other. Bo Jackson was involved. And at that time, he was like probably the strongest professional athlete in the world. So you see the mound moving every time Bo Jackson like moves. The mound of people is moving with him. And eventually they're separated, and Robbie Ventura gets kicked out, and the umpire comes up to Nolan Ryan and goes, awesome. And that was it. But here's the thing that kind of ruined me to baseball and why I don't watch baseball to this day. That was the first game I ever saw. The rest of them were a little boring after that. Because I just thought that happened every time. I thought that at some point in every game, there would be like a face-off, and that didn't happen. So that's about the time I started watching professional wrestling. But expecting one thing and getting another was certainly my experience in baseball. Expecting one thing and getting another was certainly Mr. Ventura's expectation that day as he approached the mound. And expecting one thing and getting another is simply the world that we live in right now. And leadership and influence is tough enough under the best of circumstances. In the wild times that we live right now, it is even harder. So I want to give you some confessions. I didn't tell them I was going to do this. There's some confessions that your leadership needs to make for you. Doug, could you come up here for just a second? Just stand right here, nice and far away from me. And Pastor Ed, if you want to join me up here. And where is Margo? Here's Ed, you can stand right back there. And Margo, if you want to stand over here by the keyboard. These are confessions about leadership that everyone can agree on, but oftentimes no one will admit. Margo, can you read this and then really loud and then hold it up? And I want you to read it after she reads it.
We don't have all the answers.
Everybody?
We don't have all the answers.
Okay, maybe you didn't know that about the leadership of this church or any church, but we don't have all the answers. Ed, read this one nice and loud. And
we don't always know what to do.
All right, confession is good for the soul. And Doug, I thought this would be really good for you to just nice and loud and proud.
We are making it up as we go along.
We are making it up as we go along. Okay, thank you guys for your honesty. I appreciate that. You can sit back down. So that's the reality about the leadership of this church, but the reality is that's the reality in your life, because we've already established that you lead someone or something, you influence someone or something, and you probably don't have all the answers. In fact, especially in times where we are in these wild set of circumstances, you may feel like you're making it up as you go along. But here's something we're going to learn from an Old Testament story in Scripture today, that uncertainty is a part of life, and uncertainty is why we need leadership and why we need influencers. Because if everything was certain, we would need less leadership. Leadership and influence is something that we call a stewardship. Now, when we think about stewardship, you think about stuff, right? When we talk about stewardship, we talk about money, right? Got to be good stewards of our money. Or if we don't talk about money, we might just be talking about resources in general. You need to be a good steward of your stuff. But you need to be a good steward of the leadership and the influence that God has given you. Leadership and influence is temporary. The influence you have today, you might not have tomorrow, depending on what the people are or the circle of people are. The influence that you'll have 3 weeks from now, you might not have today. And knowing that there's an expiration date on your influence and on your leadership should actually inform how you use it. And finally, and perhaps this is the most challenging, we are accountable for how we use our influence. We are accountable for how we leverage our leadership. So we're going to look at a story in the Old Testament. It's from 580 BC. And in 580 BC, there was a great leader who confused progress with greatness. And he was brought to his senses in an unusual way. The man's name is King Nebuchadnezzar, and he was king of Babylon. Babylon is in modern-day Iraq. And at this point in time, in 580 BC, the king of Babylon would have been at least one of the top most powerful men in the world, if not the most powerful men in the world. This was a period of time where the Jewish people, the Hebrew people, God's people, were in exile. Or they kind of considered it being in time out, that they had been 20 years prior to this. They'd gone in, they'd plucked the best and the brightest out of Judah and brought them to Babylon. That's where we get Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That's where all those guys came from. And this king, King Nebuchadnezzar, just truly and genuinely believed in his heart that his god, the Babylon god Marduk, was the God worthy of worship and more powerful than the Hebrew God. Now, Daniel, who's the writer of the book we're going to look at today, Daniel records his story. Daniel becomes a trusted advisor to the king. And Daniel is going to tell us what happens when King Nebuchadnezzar's leadership and influence is questioned. If you want to follow along, it's Daniel chapter 4. The verses are also listed in your Bible or in your worship folder. Daniel chapter 4, verses 4 and 5 says, I, Nebuchadnezzar, was at ease in my house and prospering in my palace. I saw a dream that made me afraid. As I lay in bed, the fancies and the visions of my head alarmed me. So as a trusted advisor to the king, Daniel would have been brought in to interpret this dream. In verse 13, he tells us what the dream is. He says, I saw in the visions of my head as I lay in bed, a watcher, a holy one, came down from heaven. He proclaimed aloud and said thus, chop down the tree and lop off its branches, strip off its leaves and scatter its fruit. Let the beasts flee from under it and the birds from its branches, but leave the stump of its roots in the earth, bound with a band of iron and bronze, amid the tender grass of the field. Let him be wet with the dew of heaven. Let his portion be with the beasts in the grass of the earth. Let his mind be changed from a man, and let a beast's mind be given to him. And let 7 periods of time pass over him. This sentence is by the decree of the watchers, the decision by the word of the holy ones, to end that the living may know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will and sets over the lowliest of men. Now, if I was the king, I would be rightfully confused by that dream. The dew on his body and the mind of a beast, 7 times will pass. What does all that mean? And Daniel's brought in, and Daniel actually says in verse 19, he says, my Lord, may the dream be for those who hate you and its interpretation for your enemies. Like, you wish this was happening to somebody else. But unfortunately, king, this is happening to you. This is the interpretation, O king, verse 24. It is a decree of the Most High which has come upon my lord the king, that you shall be driven from among men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. You shall be made to eat grass like an ox, and you shall be wet with the dew of heaven, and 7 periods of time shall pass over you till you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will. And as it was commanded to leave the stump of the roots in the tree, your kingdom shall be confirmed for you from the time that you know heaven rules. Therefore, O king, let my counsel be acceptable to you. Break off your sins by practicing righteousness and your iniquities by showing mercy to the oppressed, that there may be perhaps a lengthening of your prosperity. So he interprets this dream and he says, actually, king, the dream's not very symbolic at all. It's actually fairly literal. You're going to be turned to a beast of a man. You're going to be separated from people, and you're going to be separated from people until you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will. You're going to be separated from people until you realize that your leadership and your influence was given to you from the Most High, and it is something for you to steward and you to take care of because it is temporary. Now, Nebuchadnezzar was terrified. And it says in verse 29, at the end of 12 months, nothing happened. Nothing happened for a year. At the end of 12 months, he was walking on the roof of the royal palace of Babylon. And the king answered and said, is not this great Babylon, which I have built my mighty power as a royal residence for the glory of my majesty? And you can almost hear in the story someone in the background go, don't say that. Do you not remember the dream? And so the music changes, and it says, while the words were still in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven. O King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is spoken. The kingdom has departed from you. You shall be driven from among men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. You shall be made to eat grass like an ox. 7 periods of time shall pass over you until you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will. Immediately, immediately the word was fulfilled against Nebuchadnezzar. He was driven from among men, ate grass like an ox, and his body was wet with the dew of heaven, till his hair grew as long as eagle's feathers, and his nails were like birds' claws. This is actually a noted psychotic event known as boanthropy. It's where you believe mentally that you are some sort of bovine creature, and it actually shows up in the Bible. So Nebuchadnezzar is driven away. This is an extraordinary tale. He's walking on the palace of his roof, and he's talking about how great he is. He's talking about the prosperity of which he has brought upon his palace. And in that very moment, he is turned into a beast of a man. At the end of days, Nebuchadnezzar lifted my eyes to heaven, and my reason returned to me, and I blessed the Most High, and I praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, and he does according to his will among the hosts of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say to him, what have you done? Verse 37 says, now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of heaven, for all his works are right and his ways are just. And those who walk in pride, he is able to humble. Take it from me, I've got grass on my breath. Now, if that was the end of the story, it's a pretty good story, right? Okay, here's somebody that got caught up in their own pride. Here's somebody that caught up in their own prosperity, and God humbled them in a very extraordinary way, and they repented, and, you know, praise the Lord, we could all go home. But there is a chapter later. 40 years later, King Nabonidus was over Babylon, and the Persians, led by Cyrus the Great, were headed toward Babylon. One of the regent kings, King Belshazzar, became in charge of Babylon as King Nabonidus was working the campaigns and fighting the Persians. And Belshazzar had a different take on the Hebrew God. The Bible tells us it refers to Belshazzar as King Nebuchadnezzar as his father. It was actually his grandfather. So Belshazzar is the grandson of Nebuchadnezzar. It refers to him as his father in the generational sense or the genealogy sense. But they were all pretty confident that as the Persians surrounded Babylon, that the Persians would never, ever breach the walls of Babylon. So Belshazzar does what any good king would do. He throws a party. And at the party, he decides to pull out some artifacts, some remnants, some symbols of the Hebrew faith. Because when Babylon had originally plundered Judah, they pulled out goblets and all these things from the temple, all these sacred things. And verse 5 of the book of Daniel says, King Belshazzar made a great feast for 1,000 of his lords and drank wine in front of the 1,000. Belshazzar, when he tasted the wine, commanded the vessels of gold and of silver that Nebuchadnezzar, his father, his grandfather, had taken out of the temple in Jerusalem be brought, that the king and his lords and his wives and his concubines might drink from them. Then they brought in the golden vessels that had been taken out of the temple, the house of God in Jerusalem, and the king and his lords, his wives, and his concubines drank from them. They drank wine and praised the gods of gold and silver, bronze, iron, wood, and stone. They praised Marduk and the gods of bronze, iron, wood, and stone. Immediately, the fingers of a human hand appeared and wrote on the plaster of the wall of the king's palace opposite the lampstand. And the king saw the hand as it wrote. The king's color changed and his thoughts alarmed him. His limbs gave way and his knees knocked together. The king called loudly to bring in the enchanters and the Chaldeans and the astrologers. The king declared to the wise men of Babylon, whoever reads this writing and shows me its interpretation shall be clothed with purple and have a chain of gold around his neck, and shall be the third ruler in the kingdom. You may have heard this story before. You may be familiar with it. This is a story of aptly called the handwriting on the wall. King Belshazzar is having a party. He's feasting and using all this stuff that they've plundered from the Hebrew people. They are praising the false gods, and a hand comes in and just starts writing on the wall. Now, he does exactly what you would do. He freaks out because that's scary. And it said, the Bible says his knees knock together, right? And so he's freaking out, and he sends for interpreters. He sends for magicians. He sends for sorcerers. And by this point, Daniel is an old man. He's probably about 70 years old. And Daniel, once again, returns to the king by way of the queen. The queen, verse 10, because of the words of the king and his lords, came into the banqueting hall. The queen declared, O king, live forever. Let not your thoughts alarm you, nor your color change. There's a man in your kingdom in whom the spirit of the holy gods, in the days of your father, light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of the gods, were found in him. King Nebuchadnezzar, your father, the father of the king, made him the chief magician, enchanters, Chaldeans, and astrologers because of an excellent spirit, knowledge, and understanding to interpret dreams, explain riddles, and solve problems were found in Daniel. Let Daniel be called, and he will give you the interpretation. So Daniel is brought before the king. Verse 17 says, Daniel answered and said before the king, let your gifts be for yourself, and give your rewards to another. The gold chain, the robe, all that, I don't need that. Nevertheless, I will read the writing to the king and make known to him the interpretation. O king, the Most High God gave Nebuchadnezzar, your father, kingship and greatness and glory and majesty. And because of the greatness that he gave him, all peoples, nations, languages trembled and feared before him. Whom he would, he killed, and whom he would, he kept alive. Whom he would, he raised up, and whom he would, he humbled. But when his heart was lifted up and his spirit was hardened so that he dealt proudly, he was brought down from his kingly throne, and his glory was taken from him. He reminds him of this story. You know, your grandfather stumbled around like a cow because he got a little full of himself. He was fed grass like an ox, and his body was wet with the dew of heaven until he knew that the Most High God rules the kingdom of mankind and sets over it whom he will. And you, his son Belshazzar, have not humbled your heart, though you knew all this, but you have lifted up yourself against the Lord of heaven. And the vessels of his house have been brought in before you. You and your lords, your wives, your concubines have drunk from them, and you have praised the gods of gold and silver, bronze, iron, wood, and stone, which do not see or hear or know. But the God whose hand is in your breath, and whose are all your ways, you have not honored. And then he reads the handwriting on the wall. Mene, mene, tekel, and person. And it's the three things about the king's leadership, it's the three things about your influence and leadership that we all need to remember. Mene, God has numbered the days of your kingdom and brought it to an end. That is to say, king, your leadership and your influence is temporary. Says Tekel, you have been weighed in the balances and found wanting. That is to say, king, you are accountable for your decisions. And in the scales of justice, you're coming up short. And finally, Perez or Parson, your kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. That is to say, your kingdom is being given away because it wasn't yours to begin with. Babylon knew that Persia could never breach the walls, but Cyrus the Great was great and pretty good at what he did. And so they actually just waited for the water to come up a little bit, and they went under the walls. So Babylon was right. They could not breach the walls. But Persia conquered Babylon, and verse 30 says, that very night, Belshazzar, the Chaldean king, was killed. And he was killed because he did not recognize the Most High God gives to whom he chooses. So sometimes in Scripture, we get an example of what to do. Be like Jesus, be like Peter, be like Moses. Sometimes in Scripture, we get an example of what not to do. Don't be like Jonah. Don't be like Belshazzar. But in this story, we get two examples of what not to do. Two men that were puffed up in their own leadership, and two men that forgot the simple rule about leadership and the simple rule about influence that we all have to consider from time to time, is that it's a matter of stewardship. You should treat the influence and the leadership in your life just as you treat your money. How am I going to spend it? How am I going to share it? What is it going to cause? When we view our influence as a temporary stewardship of which we are accountable for, we are much less likely to spend it all or leverage it all for the wrong reasons. So if you're leading a family or you're leading a group or you're leading coworkers or you're influencing people, and like we said, we are all influencing people. That influence that you've been given, you are not the king of Babylon. But that influence that you've been given is so extraordinary and so significant, and it can be taken away. So what are we going to do with it? What are you going to do with your leadership and your influence? Sometimes it's difficult when you preach out of the Old Testament, because at some point I want to get to Jesus, right? Like we need to leave on Jesus. But this is a perfect example, because Jesus shows us exactly what to do with our leadership and our influence. In Philippians chapter 2, when Paul is talking about Christ, he says, "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped." And the Greek word there for grasp is actually robbed or snatched or something he shouldn't have had. So it's as if to say, Jesus at any point in his life could have played the God card. Hey, I'm God, I don't have to do that. Hey, I'm God, I can lead these people in a different direction. But the Bible tells us that he never did that, because he never saw that as something he should steal, because it wasn't his for that moment. So when we think about leadership and influence, we look at the example of Christ, who led with a servant's heart, who led in, and this is difficult, it's difficult for everybody, especially when you get some stuff. He led with a sense of humility, putting others before himself. And so when we want to talk about how to influence people, we follow the example of Jesus Christ. So how does this apply in a practical sense? What do we do with this story of thousands of years ago? Some of you have influence that you are not stewarding properly. God has placed people in your life, and you are the primary contact. You're the point of influence. And you step back and you say, it's none of my business. I don't want to get involved. It's not my place. And God's saying, I've put them there for a reason. I've put them there because you're there, and this is temporary, and you're accountable for how you handle that. Some of you, let's talk a practical application here, because it's right here in front of us. Some of you need to be baptized, right? You've been a Christian for 6 months or 6 years or 60 years, and you've never followed the Lord in believer's baptism because you're scared, or you don't like standing in front of people, or you still have questions about your faith, you just can't reconcile. But here's the reality, and I can say this. This is not hypothetical. I've seen this happening. And this is one of the great things about my job of getting to watch this up close. You have no idea the power of your testimony. I have seen parents get baptized after their children, because their child who puts their faith and trust in Jesus Christ is willing to stand up and say, I believe that Jesus died for my sins and rose from the grave. And the parent, in a little bit of shame, says, I can say that. If they can stand up there and say that, I can say that. Friends, young folks, students, you have no idea the influence you have over the people in your life when you publicly say, you know what, this is what I believe. And you don't know. You don't know, but we do know that to be a steward of the influence that we've been given, we've got to step into some uncomfortable places. When we think about the wildness of the world that we live in, when we think about the uncertainty that surrounds us, verse 30 of Daniel chapter 4, excuse me, verse 30 of Daniel chapter 5. It's not verse 30 at all. Verse 32 of Daniel chapter 4. Until you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will. How can some people live in this incredible peace and this incredible calm, especially in 2020? Because they know that the Most High rules over all and gives to whom he will. How can people have peace and participate in a world that is scary? How can we go to jobs that are corrupted? And how can we vote in a system that's corrupted? And how can we engage in commerce that's corrupted and still have peace? Because we know that the Most High God is sovereign over all. That Nebuchadnezzar, with all of his faults, was in place in that kingdom in some way because the Most High God ordained it. Isn't that scary and challenging to think about? That the challenging people that are in your life or the people that are in need that are in your life are there because the Most High God says that's exactly where they need to be because that's exactly where you are and I expect you to do something with your influence. That's extremely challenging to me because I know that in times past I have not stewarded my influence appropriately. Adults, grown-ups, look up here. Kids, earmuff it for me. You know why y'all need to watch your mouth? It's not because if you hit your finger with a hammer and you say a dirty word, you're going to go to hell. You watch your mouth because your kids are listening. And you're teaching them how to emote. And you're teaching them how to participate in civil discourse. And you're teaching them how to argue with their spouse. And you're teaching them how to have disagreements with their family in the future. If you have a child or a grandchild or a niece or a nephew or anybody young that looks up to you, your influence is so extraordinary. And it's given to you by the Most High God. The early church did this well. They lived their lives in such a way where oftentimes they would have to challenge the world around them. Oftentimes they would have to stick their neck out, but they never took advantage of the influence that the Most High God had put that they were to be stewards of. So my question for us and my challenge for each and every one of us as we go into this week and as we live in these wild times, how will you steward your influence? What will your prayer, can we pray? Can we agree in prayer that the Holy Spirit will ping our conscience when we overlook those significant moments of which we are to be aware of? Can we pray? Are we bold enough to pray, God, I want you to put people in my path that I can influence? Boy, that's scary, right? God, I want you to put people in my path that I can influence because you've done something for me that I want to tell other people about. Are we bold enough to make that prayer? Or are we bold enough just to say, you know what, God, the influence you've given me, I'm not going to squander because I know it's temporary. I know I'm supposed to steward it, and I know that I'm accountable for what I do with it. Nebuchadnezzar got it wrong, and he repented, and he had that beautiful doxology at the end of chapter 4. Belshazzar got it wrong, and the consequences were much more grave. I pray for you today. I pray for us today that we do not squander the influence that God has given us to to the people that he has given us in crazy, crazy times. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for bringing us to this place. We thank you for the celebration of worship, just people that have committed to lifting their eyes upward and proclaiming you to be God and you to be awesome. God, we thank you for the truth that's in your word and how it can convict us, how it can challenge us. God, each and every one of us has people in our lives. It might be family members, friends, coworkers, acquaintances. And God, I pray that we steward this tremendous influence that you've given us, that we never squander an opportunity to share our testimony, that we never squander an opportunity to, yes, sometimes even ask difficult questions, engage in difficult conversations, because the Most High God has put these people in our path, and it is up to us to steward that immense responsibility. God, we thank you for the ways that you continue to bless us, that you continue to cover us with your grace and mercy. We ask that you dismiss us with your blessing this morning. Keep us safe. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for being with us today. You may stand and you are dismissed. Have a great week.